This car is almost as old as I am. One way to keep your car running a long time is to take it to Minute Tune regularly. While you wait, Minute Tune's expert technicians will treat your car to a 46-point tune-up or a 10-point brake job. And you get a written guarantee. Good at over 50 locations across Canada.
Special. Have your front brakes done for just $79.50 this month only.
Get guaranteed quality care where you see the Minute Tune sign.
Good morning. All the wheel dealers in the BC New Democratic Party are agog this morning. They're all agog, waiting for the finite announcement from Mike Harcourt, the mayor of Vancouver. And the questions in their minds simply are, will he go both ways? In other words, will he announce that he's going to run for the leadership of the NDP and stay as mayor of the city of Vancouver for the magnificent, glorious year of 1986 Expo? Or will he not go at all? We can't tell you yet. The announcement will be made this morning at 9:45. It may be for Harcourt a climax, or it may be an anticlimax. But meanwhile, on the sidelines, boys like Vickers and King and Passarelli and Graham Lee and Dave Stupich and Uncle Tom Cobley and Skelly, they want to know what the big shot Harcourt is going to do. Mind you, many people would tell you that Harcourt isn't known the other side of the Lionsgate Bridge, or for that matter, the Portman Bridge, and in no way could capture the NDP. The NDP, as you know, is in the parlous state with lame duck Davey doing whatever. The legislature performance really quite dreadful on both sides. So it's very important this morning to know what our nice Nelly Mike Harcourt is going to decide and announce at 9:45 in his magnificent office at the City Hall in Vancouver. I know that's the one thing you all want to know today. In the meantime, turning to our disastrous federal politics, you remember that little moment of glory which the Tories achieved. And Brian Mulroney, undoubtedly the next Prime Minister of Canada, perhaps if and so, after this little victory, he got up in the House and he said,
Madam Speaker, a most fundamental principle of British parliamentary democracy is that a government that is defeated on a tax or a money bill is a government that must leave this House.
And with me this morning is the Tory whip. That doesn't mean he's a sadist or a masochist, but he was the guy who whipped the Tories, Chuck Cook, North Vancouver, Burnaby, into little secret enclaves so that they could invade the House and catch the sleepy Liberals and defeat them. And Chuck will tell us when they will really defeat the government. Yesterday I was reprimanded by a very perceptive viewer who said that Webster's information programming was ignoring all the strikes at the BC Idol, the IBEW, Local 258, the O.T.E.U., who've got 3,500 out, a couple of 2,500 out in IBEW, and 450 gas workers. The hydro seems to be working all right. Most of you are paying your bills. But I've got Fred Trotter of the O.T.E.U. here this morning to explain at least his union's position in this endless problem with Bonner's boys in BC Hydro. But off the top this morning, while you wait expectantly for to see which way Harcourt will jump, we're going to start with a serious interview with my old buddy and former colleague who escaped from the chains and nets of open line programming, Chuck Cook, after the break.
The principle which antecedes even British parliamentary justice goes back to the Roman days. It stated, audi alteram partem. The opposition doesn't want the other side to be heard, and I say in that they are flouting justice. Yeah.
Wow. Chuck Cook is going to tell us about this lark that he pulled on December the 20th when they defeated the government on one section of the Income Tax Act and Mulroney got up rather pompously and demanded an election because of the true defeat of the government. Now, was this a gag or a... How did you organize and hide 101 noisy Tories so that you could, whatever it was...
Well, because,
so that
you as
could
you know, Jack...
rush them out from behind the drapes and defeat the Liberals like a bunch of small boys playing at a Sunday school.
Well, that's true. We have a bunch of small boys. Nothing looked more like a candy run than to see about 40 or 50 members charging down the hall with 40 seconds to get to their seat. Jack, there's a couple things about it. One of the most difficult things we have with Ottawa is to make sure the country knows exactly what's going on and to bring back to the attention of the country that what we desperately need is a federal election in this country. By defeating the government on a minor matter such as this in the House sitting in Committee of the Whole shows the laziness of the government, shows the lack of attention to their parliamentary duty of the Liberal Party, and those are the reasons we did it. That and to make sure the country understood that, darn it, the Conservatives want an election and we want it now.
How many Liberals were in the House when you all rushed out from behind the curtains when the bells rang?
I think there were 12, and another 8 dashed in that they could dig up instantly, but so there were about 20 there, and there were 67 members of the Conservative Party sitting there to vote.
In other words, you only had a few in the House yourself. They had a dozen or a dozen and a half, and then you had the others hidden in little rooms?
No. We had them all in one room, just waiting, and when it came time for the vote, boom, we rushed them in, and they voted on the amendment.
In other words, this whip you had said, come to room so-and-so. Which room was it?
228 North.
228 North. One at a time?
No, I said surreptitiously. And hope they all understood. But in other words, they came in. There's about 5 entrances to the main building of the House of Commons. And they drifted in slowly. I'd reserved the room, theoretically, to talk to some students in the United States.
And you lied to get the room.
Of course I lied to get the room, because if I'd told the sergeant-at-arms, the Liberals would have known about it 30 seconds later.
The sergeant-at-arms would have told the room the Liberals, or the word would have got the Liberals.
That's right. That's a better way to put it.
The word would have got the Liberals, and they would have rushed in their reinforcement from the bars. Do you have many bars in the House of Commons?
Between 12 and 1, there are no bars in the House of Commons, I might add. None whatsoever, sir.
None at all?
None.
You can get a drink in your subsidized dining room, of course.
No, you cannot get a drink in the subsidized dining room. You are served beer or wine. That is all you can get
in
the dining room.
Well, is that not a drink, said he with deference, respect, and humility?
I thought you meant something serious, like a martini, Jack.
Are you right in telling me that there are no bars? Let me think about that. No bars in the House of Commons.
No, Jack, but to be fair about it and honest about it, there is a liquor store on the hill, a small liquor store, and I don't think there are many offices on the hill you can walk into where there isn't a bottle at a desk or a credenza or something.
Right, so therefore, Trudeau properly said you're playing silly fools and you accepted his explanation.
Well, no, we weren't playing silly fools. What we were doing was bringing to the country's attention once more the need for a federal election, and that's our job.
And getting good national television coverage.
Well, hopefully, yes.
And even that results in you being on my program so you can tell me this little story.
Well, Jack, don't lie, because you phoned me to be on this program something like a month ago, and it was long before this incident took place.
As a matter of fact, I'm glad you mentioned that, because you were one of the people who helped to whitewash the amazing circumstances in the Mackasey case, and you were one of the people who had the gall to say that the Montreal Gazette had adversely affected the privileges of the House of Commons with its articles about the incredible Mackasey caper.
Well, in the first place, I didn't say that, Jack.
How could you do that?
You are now doing exactly the same thing. You're adversely affecting me with making those kind of a charge.
Explain yourself. Were you on the committee?
Well, on the committee, this is. The committee.
Were you on the committee?
Of course I was on the committee.
You therefore voted to reprimand in effect the Montreal Gazette.
Voted? No, there's no reprimand.
Oh.
There is not a reprimand of the Montreal Gazette in that report.
Is this accurate? Is this my information wrong that you said that the Gazette had adversely affected the House's privileges?
No, we did not say that. But what was said is, and any article that appears in a newspaper can adversely the reputation of anyone. I've seen stuff on you in the newspapers which adversely affect your reputation.
You're suggesting to me that it's perfectly proper if I have done something wrong or if you have done something wrong that your reputation be so adversely affected.
Absolutely. No question about that.
So you shot the messenger even though he was right.
No, wait a minute. There are 3 stories we had to deal with in
three
that committee.
Stories.
Initial 3 stories. After that, the Gazette went wild. They would have headlines about graft and corruption involving the others. but their other pictures weren't there. It was Mackasey's picture with them. The first three stories were fair reporting, no question about it. They reported what the president of the Montreal Board of Trade and a senior partner of Touche Roche had said at a bankruptcy hearing.
On oath.
On oath.
Making allegations that Mackasey had been a paid lobbyist.
That's
for
right.
Les ateliers de usinage olite or something, right?
Your French pronunciation is almost as good as mine.
It's execrable, right? The report did that.
Yeah.
And what were the adverse effects about Mackasey that came out in the investigation from the report?
Well, the terrible thing about it is I don't think Bryce will ever live it down. Because no matter, the fact is, there was no evidence. And the Montreal court, when he was charged, found that. There was absolutely no evidence.
On that charge.
That's right. And we could find no evidence either in the committee.
In other words,
you could clearly indict Mackasey.
Totally acquitted at the preliminary hearing of the charges
that were
laid against him.
Yeah.
All right. Who paid off Mackasey's loan on his stocks at the bank, and how much were his stocks worth to begin with, how much later, and how much did the Bank of Montreal suffer?
Well, this is really where Mackasey's trouble comes into, because he may be innocent of everything, he may be an innocent dupe. However, I don't think the public will ever accept it. When the Bank of Montreal gives up $178,000 worth of stock, which is their only security against over $400,000, which Mackasey owed the Bank of Montreal, and then turns around and accepts a transfer of those notes owed to the Bank of Montreal by Mackasey to an unknown company, 109609, and takes their notes instead of Mackasey's notes and makes the transfer. In other words, effectively relieving Mackasey of over $400,000 in debt in one fell swoop. Now, there's no evidence that it was wrong or anything, but when somebody gets a $400,000 benefit, then obviously there have to be questions asked.
From a bank.
From a bank.
A former cabinet minister.
Right.
A liberal.
Mm-hmm.
So you weren't happy with Mackasey, but there was no evidence that the House of Commons could discipline him for.
Absolutely, none. And that's unfortunate, but there wasn't any evidence that we could see there at all. Therefore, he had to be let off the hook.
Do you personally compliment the Montreal Gazette for its perceptive reporting, which brought this suspicious circumstances to the public eye?
Agreed, no question about it, and have said so publicly, I might add. Their first three stories were absolutely fair, first-rate journalism, stories that they not only had a right, but a duty to publish.
Yeah, I know. But they looked, as was said, the old boys' club was getting together to make sure the shafts and darts and arrows of public criticism couldn't touch one of your own.
Jack, you must be getting old. You're quoting Alan Fotheringham? Surely you can come up with your own lines.
I invented the quote long before Fotheringham stole it from me.
Now, is that right? I thought that was published quite a while ago.
That's Maclean's and the province. Quite useful. Let me think now. I see that Trudeau's coming up again in the next poll.
Delighted to hear it.
Explain that to a simple-minded person like me after the break. It is quite incredible, Chuck, the chatter one hears around town, that this incredible fellow Trudeau, who might just pull off some kind of peace initiative with the Chinese premier coming to Canada, with the Russians apparently being enthusiastic, with Reagan perhaps being forced to be enthusiastic in due course, there's a possibility he could come back in the polls, you know.
Oh, I don't think there's any question that if he did that, he would very substantially come back in the polls.
But wouldn't you be worried about that with your amateur leader that you have at the moment?
Not in the slightest would I be worried about that, for the simple reason is that's external affairs and that's with dealing with peace in the world. And all anybody has to do is look at this country and look at the economy of this country and look at the bad government we've got, and the rascals have got to be thrown out anyway.
Yeah, but you know, there are a lot of kind of neoliberals around the world, around even in the West, and there's a possibility that if he decides to do his trampoline act again and date Barbara Streisand once more and dash around and whatnot, that he could come up to 30 or 32% in the polls.
Well, I hope he believes that. I'd prefer to run against Trudeau again, but at the same time, there's a situation going on right now, Jack, where within a month's time, I think some determinations can be made. If Trudeau steps down by the end of this month, which is a distinct possibility, there will be a Liberal leadership convention towards the end of April and an election in June. If Trudeau doesn't step down by the end of this month, it's very likely there's going to be enough pressure from within his own caucus and enough pressure from the Liberal Party to get him to move that if he wants to stay, he's going to have to call an election anyway in April. So I think you can make a safe assumption
that
a June election.
In your own partisan manner, what you're saying is
that totally nonpartisan.
If he decides to stay, he's going to have to call his own election sometime this spring.
That's right.
Because otherwise, are you suggesting that the boys in the back room like Coots and Davey are going to go to him and say, out, foul, damned spot?
Yes, I think you're going to see that happen. And not only that, but you're going to see the rest of the party becoming very quietly impatient to the point where you could have a revolution, quite frankly, within the caucus of the Liberal Party. They are terribly unhappy with his leadership.
I know, they've been unhappy for years, but nobody's got guts enough to do or say anything about it.
Oh, well, now, I think Mr. Senator Ray Perot has made some comments out here, even.
But he doesn't matter.
Reid out of Ontario, and many others, as a matter of fact. And some of the comments that have been made in Toronto, as an example, no, it's coming.
Now,
and they are splitting apart.
Your boy Mulroney, I must say, looks very handsome and long-jawed and glib in the House of Commons. But you really haven't. The only policy thing that you've done that I can recall is that you've allied yourself with Monique Bijan on the Canada Health Act.
Well, you want to talk about policy, Jack, and that's what the press wants us to talk about. And we won't do it. And we won't talk
stupid.
Those kind of policies.
It would be stupid to talk about policy.
There is a
from
book
your point of view.
There's a book, Where I Stand, which outlines Mulroney's whole thinking in terms of policy. Policy issues are being discussed. Policy issues will be coming out from the Conservative Party as we go along. But we'll do it on our timetable, not on yours.
In other words, when you've got 56 percentage points in the polls, it's stupid to rock the boat by making policy mistakes such as Joe Clark did.
Well, we don't want to make any mistakes. That's important. But also, the Canadian people will know exactly where the Conservatives stand on everything before they have to go and vote.
But we know where you stand now in the Canada Health Act.
Of course,
you stand with Monique Bijan and the Liberals.
Well, as Mr. Mulroney says, the Canada Health Act is a sacred trust health care for Canadians.
So the Tories are against extra billing of any kind?
That would be the indication, yes.
The Tories are against deterrent fees in the scheme?
That would seem to be the indication.
The Tories, therefore, have split with their blood brother's social credit on those policies as being applied now in British Columbia.
Well, in the first place, don't call social credit our blood brothers.
They're your blood brothers.
No,
of course they
are. No, they're not.
You would vote social credit in this province. You know that perfectly well.
I'd vote Conservative, of course.
If you had a candidate.
Well, if we have candidates, yes.
And if you don't have a candidate, you'd vote social credit.
You bounce all over the map, don't you, Jack?
You certainly wouldn't vote
NDP. If you can't get me one place, you want to hit somewhere else, don't you?
Perfectly correct.
Yeah.
Perfect. How long have you been a member of the House of Commons now?
A little over 5 years now.
A little over 5 years. How long till you qualify for a pension?
Oh, that takes over six, but that's a minor pension after 6 years.
Just minor.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. If you're going to get a reasonable pension, you have to serve a full 15 years.
Full 15 years. How old are you now?
Old enough, Jack.
Answer the question, please. It's a simple question.
I think I'm 57, but I lost track. I'm about 10, 12 years younger than you are, Jack.
Eight. And a half. You seem to be quite bright this morning. In that case, we can put them to the phones. Let's hear you be nasty to Chuck Cook, okay? No nice calls. Nasty calls. I want all the anti-Tories and all the Liberals to come out of the closet and the woodworks.
Well, I hope you can find a Liberal or two.
Yeah, kind of difficult these days. The only one I know quit the party. Calls to Chuck Cook after the break. I can never understand why you make Sink Stevens your Minister of External Affairs. Why didn't... Well, he'll go to the Senate. Do assure me that, will you, please?
No, I won't assure you of that. Sink Stevens happens to be an outstanding member of Parliament and a pretty good guy.
He's got an outstanding voice, and he belongs somewhere to the right of, you know... Well, we'll use Genghis Khan. I can't think of anybody else.
Well, as Sink said, it's just amazing, now that he hasn't anything to do with Treasury Board, how important external relations are for this country.
From Campbell River, I think it is, to Chuck Cook.
Yeah, good morning, Jack. I have a question for Mr. Cook. Before they were defeated last time in government, they said that they were going to come out with a mortgage interest income tax deduction plan. I was just wondering if they got back into power, if they would bring that in.
Well, that's a possibility, but I'll tell you exactly what's going on. At the moment, we are examining the books of Canada to the extent we can and looking at the amount of money that's available. And that is one of the things that we'd love to do, but I can't answer your question until we've had a better look to see whether it's financially feasible at all with what's happened. You know, we've got a $30 billion deficit this year, probably $31 billion, so who knows whether we'll be able to do it immediately.
So there's no point in buying Mulroney's book to find if that policy is shown, because it's not.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
That's right. Thought not. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Yep.
Yes, is this the same Chuck Cook that threw out dollar bills from a radio station in Winnipeg years ago? He's noted for his tricks, and I guess we can expect some more tricks in the House of Commons.
They call
him
Tricky Chucky. Did you throw dollar bills out of the window of a radio station in, where was it, Pusca Bay?
It was in Winnipeg. It was January the 10th, 1947. I was 18 years old, and I guess that was the first time I made the national news.
Well, tell me about it.
Oh, no, Jack. No. That's long old history.
Anyway, you did throw dollar bills out of a radio station and made the national news.
And it's been bugging me my whole life ever since.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't know.
A youthful prank, and here you are at somewhere dignified, talking to a man as distinguished as you are, and somebody has to raise this again.
All is forgiven.
Okay.
I'm sorry he asked you. Go ahead, please.
Okay, Chucky, I'd like to ask you something. Like, in my comparison notes of all the politics I know, I compare social credit with with you guys, the conservatives, and I compare the NDP with the liberals. Now, it seems like one is for one thing and one is for another. When do you think we'll have a government representing the people?
Well, as soon as we have a federal election, sir, then you will have a government representing the people if the conservatives win the election.
No. You misunderstand what I'm saying. I compare social credit to NDP, or I compare the two, and one is big business, and one is giving everything away. When are we going to have something for us, the people?
Well, are you talking provincially or federally, sir?
I compare the provincial and the federal, and that's the comparison I make with the NDP, liberal, progressive, conservative, social credit.
Yeah, that's not a bad comparison. The liberals, of course, have got three mouths and four heads. They are very much big business, and they pretend to be of the people. The Tories, at least, are for big business.
Well, that's unfair, too, Jack, because the Tories are middle of the road. Remember, it is the progressive conservative party right in the middle. Sure, small business is what this country needs, and that's where the money should go.
A pointless philosophical discussion, really, to be quite honest. Go ahead, please.
It's not pointless. It's a good discussion.
Mr. Cook?
I realize it's okay.
No, Mr. Cook, yes. Go ahead to Mr. Cook.
Yes, Mr. Cook. I got a question for you. I'm still a young man. I've been growing up, and ever since I started watching politics, the Liberals have been the ones that have been in power. And in the Gallup polls, just about every year, they go down and down and down. And then finally, when the election comes up, they boost up and they beat you guys out of the government again. And when you finally did make it, you're in for a year, and then Joe Clark blew everything for you, and now you're out on the street again. What's going to happen this next election? I see Trudeau's coming up in the Gallup polls again. He's out after these peace initiatives. What's going to happen? Are you guys going to lose again or what?
We're not going to lose again because you've got a leader there that's going to sweep this country. We're going to take seats in Quebec. We're going to take seats in every province. We're going to have really the first national government this country's had for a long time, with strong representation from all parts of it. That's important to this country.
That's certainly the way the polls look at the moment. Go ahead from Whitehorse.
Yes, good morning. Jack, when you asked for a call from the Liberals, I had to chortle a little bit, because I think you can probably hold a Liberal convention in the phone booth out here.
Right.
But when talking about the merits of the various leaders, when you spoke of Trudeau increasing in popularity, I couldn't help but remember the last great unpleasantness or pleasantness, the Tory convention, leadership convention. I suspect that most Liberals in the country were rooting for Joe Clark because he probably was the best thing that they had going for them. By the same token, I think that Mr. Cook and other conservatives are probably hoping that Pierre Trudeau will retain the leadership because he's probably the best thing they've got going for him.
Yeah.
Correct. That's true. That's true. They think he's the biggest handicap the Liberals have, right?
Yes. But,
Well, Mike Lalonde's in there, too, you know. He's quite a handicap.
Yeah, but he doesn't want to be premier, you know. He doesn't want to be prime minister, Lalonde. He's just a hatchet man.
Yeah, but I have to agree with Mr. Cook as well, that regardless of who becomes or remains as the Liberal leader, it's time for a change. After a party's been in power for too long, they have to be reminded that they don't rule by divine right. They rule by the will of the people.
Anyway,
I'm convinced there will be a change.
You're one of Nielsen's boys, are you?
Well, you can call me that, I suppose.
Nobody else to vote for. Go ahead, please.
Morning, Jack.
Morning.
Morning, Chuck.
Morning.
Two questions I'd like to ask you, and then I'll hang up and listen. One of them is, every time you ask a politician, Jack, how much of an index, how much pension he's getting, he never wants to talk about it very long, and he never wants to get into this index pension bit. The second part I'd like to ask you is, what are they going to do about the income tax? We're being taxed to death right now. It's over at 67% of our income, our total income. There's Lotto Canada, there's Westerns, there's the provincials. Where are these millions of dollars going? And God knows they must be taking more money in these lottos than they ever took in an income tax. And when is are the politicians of this country going to stand up and start protecting one another? And the conservatives are protecting the liberals because they never get down and ask them questions about where all this money's going. And God knows we're overtaxed.
Okay, bye. That's a good point. Now, as a matter of fact, though, this incredible hysteria in this province about 649 Lotto is demeaning to a civilized nation, isn't it?
I would agree.
Disgusting.
Yeah,
and nobody ever knows where these lottery monies go, do they?
Well, no, I'm not so sure about that.
Well,
you have a provincial lotteries man sitting in Victoria, and it seems to me he issues an annual report each year indicating where the money has gone to.
And I couldn't even tell you. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with what they do, but I'm saying there's certainly a lack of easily available information on how the costs and the expenses.
I don't buy
lottery tickets because they're always giving away bonus prizes, which are obviously unclaimed prizes from previous times.
That's right.
It's a dirty, messy business.
It is a foul business, and the opportunities of winning are absolutely fantastic.
And they are the mark of a banana republic.
It's
like Mexico, isn't it?
Yeah, I would agree with that.
And one thing the Tories will do will stop all these dirty lotteries.
I didn't say that. Because many of them are provincial, of course.
Yeah,
talk to your provincial government.
I realize that.
But I'm glad you do.
But they've still got $1 million or $2 million budget trying to clear up the federal lotteries.
Yeah, and they're back in the business again.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. Cook. In the investigation in the House into Mr. Mackasey, didn't they ask him why he was paid $400,000? Or he got a benefit of $400,000?
Well, because he had a very, very good financial advisor who arranged the deal for him. The Bank of Montreal really couldn't see any way they could extract that $400,000 from Mr. Mackasey, and when they were offered an opportunity to give up the security of $178,000 in stocks and take notes from what they thought was a reputable company that could pay the thing, the bank was delighted to do it. That's why the bank did it, allegedly, or as far as we know.
What did Mackasey say to that?
He said, great.
Was Mackasey questioned by the committee?
Yes, Mackasey was questioned by the committee.
But the other two men are still under trial, aren't they not?
Well, they were acquitted on two charges. They have now been charged under the Bankruptcy Act in Quebec, and they are facing charges again. And I suspect this time around, I think there's a distinct possibility they could be convicted on these charges, because obviously there was a great deal of hanky-panky going on in that bankruptcy.
Yeah, but Mackasey started off with $625,000 in debt, didn't he?
That's right.
And they dropped down to $178,000 in assets. And then this other company moves in, and then the Bank of Montreal says, ta-ta.
That's right.
To Mackasey.
Oh, more than that, the Bank of Montreal also forgave $180,000 in interest to Mackasey. Just forgave him that.
Well, they asked why they forgave him?
Well, because there was no hope of collecting it, that's why. Because they did that in order to get an extra $50,000 cash out of Mackasey, which he borrowed from a good friend in Montreal so he could keep his house. Bryce was in a pretty tough financial situation at that time.
He certainly was, but it's strange behavior for a member of the House of Commons.
But what benefit was given that this was forgiven?
What benefit was given? Well, the notes that the bank took on 109609, a company that they thought was going to be paying the interest and also the principal of the $400,000. Unfortunately, that company didn't last long, and it went bankrupt as well.
It was Harrison who said that Mackasey had been acting as a paid lobbyist for a company.
That's right.
And that was the charge on which Mackasey was acquitted, on which there was no committal at the preliminary hearing.
That's right.
The judge said there were no grounds for it.
That's right.
Can this ever be opened again because of these other two gentlemen's trial?
Not likely, sir, and not likely will any evidence come out at that trial which would change any of the findings, really.
And Mackasey
the evidence isn't there.
Mackasey never did sue the Montreal Gazette for libel, slander, defamation, or anything else, did he?
No, he didn't. Harrison started an action, and Harrison has not proceeded with the action against the Gazette.
Go ahead, please, from Merritt.
Yes, Mr. Cook. It makes me sick to hear of you politicians hiding people in rooms and rushing down at the last minute to vote. I am not a liberal, but I am convinced that Prime Minister Trudeau is the only man with enough intelligence to run this country right now. Brian Mulroney scares me to heck every time he opens his big jaw.
Found one.
And why don't we all get behind Trudeau and support things like his peace mission? If you knew how the ordinary people hate it to sit down and watch a speech that Trudeau is making, and they can't hear a word he's saying because the opposition is hollering and screaming and stamping their feet. I don't think you can give us any answers, Mr. Cook, because the answers you give us now aren't going to be followed through anyway.
I think, ma'am, you deserve a couple of answers. In the first place, there is no question that any time Mr. Trudeau was speaking in the House of Commons, you can hear him. There may be a few catcalls, but at the same time, there are microphones in the House, and it comes through perfectly loud and clear. Secondly, we should all get behind Mr. Trudeau, eh? Just look what Trudeau has done to this country. As far as his peace mission is concerned, there isn't anybody in this country who doesn't want him to succeed with it. No one. Certainly our party does. Certainly Mr. Clark has been assigned particularly to help in any way we can. It's totally nonpartisan, the peace mission. But if you look at this country and you look at your taxation, you look at a $31 billion deficit, you look at 2 million unemployed, and then you tell me Mr. Trudeau's going to do a good job for this country, I couldn't get behind that man except to kick him. Thank you, my dear.
And thank you, Chuck Cook. Next, Fred Trotter of the O.T.E.U. And we'll break into Fred. We'll do a bit with Fred, and then we'll give you this agogish announcement by Mike Harcourt. After the break. Fred Trotter is the president of the O.T.E.U., which is the Office and Technical Employees Union, which is largely involved in a major way in government organizations. For instance, you're certified in I.C.B.C.
That's great, Jack.
Certified in B.C. Hydro.
Right.
What other government operations?
We've got MTOC.
MTOC, that's a Metro Transit operation.
That's correct.
Anything else?
In the public sector, that would be the three that we represent.
These are your three big ones.
Right.
Now, how many, who's on strike? Who's on first? Who's on strike at the Hydro at the moment? And why is it that myself, a fairly socially aware person, doesn't even notice anything going wrong?
Okay, first of all, just to bring you up to date, the contracts all expired on the 31st of March of 83. And the gas workers had a real difficulty with an issue that they had. And as a result, the gas workers started on job action around the 5th of October. That job action escalated to the point that on the 15th of November, they went out in terms of the gas operation totally, and that affected about 300 of our members. Now, that continued to escalate up until the 25th of November, and at that point in time, we had practically two-thirds of our members ship out, and a number of the IBW electrical workers were also affected. At that point, all three unions went on strike, and that strike has continued.
So, therefore, on strike at the moment, we have Local 213 of the IBEW, the gas workers, 450 of them.
Right.
Right?
Right.
And they don't seem to, well, not, you can't give me the details, but they don't seem to be near a settlement.
That's correct.
Right. Then we've got the IBEW man, okay. About 2,500, Local 258.
Okay.
They're out, they came out then, and they're still out. But they've got a ratification vote on a potential settlement.
That's correct. What happened, they came to a tentative agreement with Hydro on the 18th of December. And under that agreement, they are recommending it to their members, and their members are voting on it, and that vote will be concluded on the 14th of January, as I understand.
Right. Now, even if that's a yes vote, forgetting you for the moment, the pickets from the gas workers could still seriously affect the work for the IBEW people, even if they accept the vote.
Very much so.
Right. Now we come to the O.T.E.U. You came out full scale when? 25th of November?
25th of November.
How many employees?
Well, we represent 3,400 members.
So you've got 3,400.
Right.
2,500 and 500. So there's more than 6,000 hydro employees out on the streets right now.
Yeah, I would say somewhere around 6,500.
6,500 right now. Are you at a total deadlock with your in your negotiations with the hydro?
As far as I'm concerned at this point, on the 30th of December, our committee tabled a proposition with Hydro and resolution of the agreement, and at that time their committee said we're not moving, that's it, and walked away from the table. Yesterday we sent a letter to Hydro indicating that if this is the situation, that maybe it's time the parties thought about a third party, a mediator or something coming into the act.
Now
one of the things that you mentioned earlier about the profile of the Hydro strike.
Yes.
You know, that's a real situation. In Hydro, the power is still on, the gas is still flowing. The people don't notice the fact that there's 66 or 6,500 families affected by this dispute. And in addition to this, Hydro is promising bonuses to its excluded staff of $25 and $50 and $100 a day for performing work of the people on strike. When you have that type of automation in a Hydro system, and then using their excluded staff to strike break, obviously it can continue for some time.
They're proving, are they not, and I'm not saying this in any nasty fashion, they're proving that they have sufficient supervisory personnel with the sufficient skills to operate the hydro regardless.
Okay.
Am I right on
that? That is correct. And what is going to happen, though, is this. The low profile of this strike, I think the people should be concerned. If there comes a major storm, which just happens, and a major shutdown of the various power lines, you're going to find then the people are going to be screaming and wondering why this thing has gone on the way it did.
Now, as far as your people are concerned, I'm still getting my bills. I got an interim billing. I have a couple of accounts. I got my interim billings, and I just paid them.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Am I being disloyal to you by doing that?
Well, I'm sorry you paid them. Number one,
I didn't even know all these people were on strike. I'd forgotten about it.
Jack, Hydro, the computer pumps those bills out with estimates, you know, estimated billing. And they're pumping those things out. They're mailing them out, going through strike-breaking firms in order to get them delivered out. And as a result, when you receive them, the thing we would ask people if they want to assist us is don't pay them.
But if I don't pay my bills and they cut off my power, my wife will cut my throat from ear to ear.
I don't think you have to worry about it. They don't have enough people in there who could go out and cut off the services and also reconnect them. That's the difficulty they would have.
Yeah, to cut off and reconnect
That's
them
right.
when the time comes. Now, it's only a couple of years. Oh, no. Is it easy to bargain with the Hydro?
It is.
I mean, do you sit down with Bob Bonner, who's the guy with the clout, or any cabinet minister who's on the board? I believe there are some cabinet ministers on the board, aren't there?
That's correct.
Do you sit down with them face to face and make a compromise deal and walk away happy? Obviously
no,
not.
No, we don't. This is one of the problems. Hydro's got a bureaucracy in negotiations. Our negotiating committee deals with people who are about five levels below the decision makers. There's a...
Oh, yeah. They've got a board of directors, they've got a chairman, they've got labor relations policy committee, the bargaining advisory committee, the operating resource groups, the advisory groups, and the bargaining committees. Well, they're pretty low down on the totem pole, aren't they?
And as far as I'm concerned, they're nothing but messengers.
How many layoffs have you had in the last couple of years?
We had between 250 and 300.
I'm going to continue with Fred Trotter, but first, after this break, I've got to get you off your agogishness on whether or not Harcourt is going to run and take over with his magnificent flamboyance and leadership of the New Democratic Party in British Columbia.
¶¶
Your Worship, we've just had your announcement. Please spell out for me succinctly why you've chickened out on the chance to become the Premier of British Columbia as the leading and obvious contender to take over the lame duck position of Davy Barrett. Why have you done this?
Well, in your usual mild, modest way, Jack, you've asked your question. I did it for the very simple reason. Where would you much rather be the mayor of a major city in the world than Vancouver in 1984, 5, and 6? With the city coming of age as a world-class city, as the most important energy center, economic center in Canada, with the all the major projects coming together quite well, and with the city centennial highlighted by Expo 86.
Let me cut through that smokescreen, please, Mr. Harcourt. You are the political animal. All your life you have been a political animal dedicated to public service. And the answer to your question, where would you rather be, obviously would be, you would rather be premier of one of the potentially most powerful and prosperous provinces in all of the world, would you not?
I'd much rather be the mayor of Vancouver, Jack, and that's my loyalty. And it really boiled down to a loyalty to the city and to my family, and I won't bore you with the details there, but I just want to seek another term. I hope the people will agree with my view of the future of this city and would like to see me there over the next 3 to 4 years.
Let me be honest with you, no doubt about it. The fact that you're running will probably cause tears in the eyes of George Pule and will end Harry Rankin's upward movement in municipal politics. That's clear. But, sir, how seriously did you consider? Did anybody ask you not to run for the leadership, any of the other key contenders to run for the leadership of the NDP?
Well, I gave it a lot of thought, Jack. As you know, I talked to you about it a couple of times, and I, from September right through until the end of December, put a lot of thought into it, and came to the conclusion, and as I said earlier, that I would make a decision early in the new year, and here it is early in the new year, and my decision is to run again for the mayor of Vancouver. And I had a lot of people speaking to me from all over the province, a good number of them wanted me to go for it, and of course others who would prefer to see me stay in the city, or some people who had access to grime because they
support
somebody else.
We're not running the mayoralty campaign at the moment, although, by the way, did you hear what George Pule said this morning? He said that the one thing you didn't want to be was unemployed in 1986, having given up the mayor of Vancouver and been defeated as leader, if you had been leader of the NDP. Not a bad crack.
Oh, not a bad one, but I'll get back at him on the tennis court.
You'll get back at him on the tennis court?
I'll get back at him. I think that's one of the main reasons he's pleased to see me staying around here.
Mr. Harcourt, as a major force in the public life of British Columbia, and looking at the declared candidates, you take away Barrett, the lame duck, and you look at Bill King, and you look at David Vickers, and you look at Graham Lee, and you look at, come on,
who are the other? Skelly.
Skelly.
Dave Stupich. Right.
Who? Oh, Passerell.
And Al Passerell. I think
give me your endorsement. Which candidate are you endorsing now?
I haven't endorsed anybody, Jack, but I think there's a good range of people there, and I think you'll see others jumping in over the next few weeks. And it's going to be a very interesting convention coming up on May the 4th, because it's going to combine not just a leadership convention, but a look at the policies and the basic directions that the party's going to take. Not that it's taken them in the 30s and 40s or in the 60s and 70s, but the directions it's going to take in the 80s and 90s. So it's a very important event for
That's
British
right.
Columbia.
And if they take your line, it'll be a good middle-of-the-road, mild-mannered, somewhat nice Nelly left-wing party.
Well, I think that there's not going to be a shift left or right in the party.
Okay, question. Does this rule out for Mayor Mike Harcourt, who is a mere stripling of 40 years of age, does it rule out a run for the leadership of the NDP at some later date?
Well, as you said, Jack, I'm just approaching, with God willing, the halfway point in my life. So there's lots of future out there ahead of us. And I enjoy public life, and I intend to be involved in public life in one way or another the rest of my life.
Do you know how I feel this morning, having known you were going to make this announcement this morning? Do you know how I feel? I feel like the young new reporter that was sent out to cover a fancy wedding came back and said, there's no story. The city editor said, why? And he said, oh, the couple were murdered in their beds last night.
Well, we had a very good sleep last night, and I'm here this morning, Jack.
Thank you, Your Worship. Okay. At least you've cleared the air, and you've left the internecine warfare of the NDP to carry on in its own gusto with you on the sidelines.
Not on the sidelines, Jack. If you're the mayor in Vancouver, that's about as front and center as you can get.
Happy New Year to you and Becky. And
thank
Justin.
You, Jack.
Thank you.
We'll see you in the golf course.
Back after the break. Now get the picture. Forget the solidarity complications, forget everything else. Since the end of November, we've had more than 6,6500 BC Hydro employees out on strike. The gas workers are at a deadlock. The IBEW, I've got a ratification vote on January the 14th, but unless the other unions have settled and are about to work, they'll still be out. The O.T.E.U. is out, and you're now talking on behalf of, you hope to talk on behalf of your 3,500, 3,400 striking members, the possibility of using a mediator.
I think there comes a point when parties should be looking, you know, right, at that avenue.
Now, I remember, said he looking at his notes, that the last time round in your contract, you got 15% and 13% in 2 years.
That's correct, Jack.
Same as the IWA got.
Basically, we were a little under because we had to rationalize some scales for our female members in the...
And you have one of the best office workers' contracts in the country.
I hope so.
There's no doubt about that. The company, where do you stand now on money? Is money the problem?
Money is an issue, but our first thing that we've got to get resolved are job security issues. We've got proposals in which are related to that. Give you an example. When we had the layoff of these 200 to 300 people, we ran into a serious problem. We have never really experienced layoffs in the past. Basically, it was done by attrition and placement, so our layoff clauses had never really been tested. When the layoffs occurred in Hydro, Hydro took a very rigid interpretation of the agreement. Under the agreement, an employee can only bump back into a previous job when it's within the same division. The parties can agree to going further. Hydro would not agree to going to allowing people to bump back into jobs they previously had. To give you an example, we had people with 10, 12, 15 years service who were laid off in that Hydro building who had done other jobs in that same building, and there's maybe 40, 50 people junior to them in those jobs. And they went ahead and they laid off those senior people. We can't live with that. We even had an individual with 28 years service subject to going out the door. We cannot live with those types of procedures. Yeah, well, we've got to get a change.
Presumably, though, they got some kind of severance packet under your contract. But the point you're making is that you stick stubbornly by the basic union principle, last hired, first fired.
To a degree, that is true.
I mean, all things being equal.
That's right. What we want to see, we want to see that a person can bump back into a job they previously held and remove that divisional restriction, get a better, and Hydro took a narrow interpretation of what the same job was. To give you an example, a person can bump into a job they previously held or a job derived from it. We had two classifications, a meter reader A and a meter reader B. The only difference is a meter reader B may deliver bills from time to time. Hydro's people would not agree that that was the same job or a job derived from it.
In other words, a meter A couldn't bump into a meter
that's
B.
That's right.
Well, that seems stupid.
That is absolutely
that's
stupid.
That's picky.
Yeah, that's right.
Ah, but let's get this clear. And we've gone through all this on the ferries and the BCGEU and all the rest of it. Do you in themselves expect, do your people or does your executive want permanent job security for your present staff? What's the answer to that?
No.
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 Are you prepared to accept layoffs?
Yes.
You want them laid, you want, though, that in a broad range of classifications to be able to bump down in any part of Hydro.
That is correct. In jobs they've previously held, they're the same job, we want that.
All right. Now, are you presently, without going into the details, exempted from the draconian provisions of Bill 3?
No, we haven't made the application on that. Until we get language that we can live with, There is no sense to trying for any exemption. Hydro would be quite prepared to take our existing language to Mr. Peck, no question, because they can basically just let people go.
But you're not prepared to do that.
We're not prepared to do that.
Now, would you happen to know if your layoff language is weaker and worse than, say, the IBEW or the 213 or 258?
Definitely, because you see, they maybe had more experience in the past with their language, and they, as a result, were able to get it in better shape. 258 accepted their agreement. I know they've made a lot of changes in their layoff language, but they said they weren't significant. 213 will accept the restoration of the language which they've got.
Now, okay, so therefore this is the key thing, is the layoff language, really.
Well, that is the big one. We've got some other things related to the same type of thing. For instance, on technological change. Hydro right now, these people, and to take care of our needs.
This is the important point I want to get clear in my own mind, and that is that if they came along tomorrow and said, okay, we've got 100 layoffs, and you have satisfactory language on the layoffs, you must accept it.
Sure. Everyone in our organization, we're not trying to say that they can't lay off for need.
All right, now what about money? The company offers, 4% over 3 years plus a cash bonus of between $450 and $900 in the final year.
All right, on money, the settlement they made with the IBEW electrical workers is one that will give them 4.5% on their wage level over the total of the 3 years. In addition, they get $1,400 up front. Hydro's position with us to date, at one point they had an offer on the table which was 0, 0, and 4 mm-hmm. over the 3 years. Uh-huh. They are now to the point where they made an offer which was 4% on the 1st of December 84. In other words, a 4% increase over 3 years. Plus $900 cash and $450 to part-time employees.
Isn't that kind of close to what the IBEW are recommending? They're getting $1,400 up front, and then on December the 1st they get 4.5%, which does them through till 86.
Yeah, 4.5%, Jack. You see, in the past, we've been... Hydro wanted the IWA level of settlement with us the last time. Okay, they wanted that. That was their direction. Now, what we're saying, the IWA settlement is 0, 4, 4.5.
Right.
Okay, that is the position which we have put forward to Hydro.
How can you compare an office worker with an IWA worker?
Which way?
I mean, well, you know, I'm a traditionalist. I'm not trying to knock you, but can you say that clerks in the O.T.E.U. should make the same guy? Same money as those guys who have less permanence in the woods and the sawmills.
Just a minute, Jack. Let's come back in terms of when you're comparing people. We're not saying job levels are identical to job levels in the IWA. We have people receiving lesser pay in areas than they do. But we also have people with very skilled people with university degree and equivalency.
Yeah, I suppose.
You know, so.
So
there's quite a difference. And what we're saying is that the standard of living of our people should be maintained equally with people in those other industries. Now, the BCGU got 0 and 4 over 2 years.
Right.
You know, Hydro isn't proposing anything similar to us.
And all they're offering now is 4% over 3 years.
3 years.
Plus a cash settlement of $450 to $900 in the last year. Now, that would not increase your wage levels.
Right.
That would merely be a bonus kind of thing.
That's correct.
You don't want to do that.
No.
You want money on your wage levels.
It should be on the wage levels. Otherwise, it's a one-shot deal and it's gone forever.
But
at this point, let me say this. I think the issues we've got to get resolved to begin with are the security things. Yes,
right.
Money's an issue, but let's get the first part out of the way first.
More, and your questions too to Fred Trotter about the forgotten strike. Have you paid your light bill? I did. After the break. Yeah, it just means the public has no sympathy with you, doesn't it?
I don't think the public generally has much sympathy with any strike or any group of people who are on strike.
Have you any, would you care to speculate on the motives of the Hydro in pushing it this hard with you? Yeah. When you tell me that the important thing is layoff, money is a factor, you say carefully, but it's a layoff and technological change.
Jack, I have no hesitation in saying that I think that Hydro really needed a strike. Hydro was under criticism from the Utilities Commission, saying that they were being too soft on their employees because they have never had any major strikes. Jim Clifford was basically suggesting that the only way to show you're tough is that you should have strikes and disputes of that nature.
Was that that special report that was done?
That's right. And as a result, I think Hydro needed to go back to the Utilities Commission next year to show that they have been tough with the employees.
Okay, the calls are to Fred Trotter. Go ahead to Fred.
Good morning, how are you?
Good, carry on.
I have absolutely no sympathy at all for the unions at all. I believe the unions came a long time ago to be protecting the workers' rights and their health and safety. You guys got your great big piece of pie in the late 60s and early 70s. I have absolutely no sympathy for any unions that are on strike. You're just trying to make the country worse. You're trying to get more money. We've got great big deficits. I'm sure there's a couple hundred thousand people here in BC that are out of work right now that would just love to take your 6,500 jobs for no, or probably even pay less.
Fred?
Well, Jack, one of the things in terms of the people who are saying they're anti-union, I think they overlooked something. Basically, the union movement has pushed and advanced the social structure under which we live in this country. One of the things that a lot of people who don't believe in unions, they somehow feel that if you take a dollar out of a union worker's pocket, it'll end up in the non-union worker's pocket. That won't happen. The structure is there. Well, if we get less, or if you treat union workers less, the people below them are going to be even worse off.
Go ahead to Fred Trotter.
Yes, Fred, I'd like to know why back in February 1983, when Hydro came to the O.T.E.U. with the proposal to extend our contract by 1 year, the O.T.E.U. members didn't get a chance to vote on that.
Okay, the Hydro came to us in February and said, look, no increase for this year. We'll roll over the contract as is for the year. There was no monetary benefit, you know, in going into accepting that, okay? What we did, we asked Hydro, will you guarantee or assure us we won't have any further layoffs? Hydro would not give that assurance. So therefore, by not accepting that offer, we have lost nothing. We haven't received any money this year. We wouldn't have received it under that agreement. So we lost nothing by it.
Well, and, we haven't gained any money by being out in strike.
No, but it really wouldn't have changed. We still, if Hydro would not ensure there wouldn't be layoffs, we needed that layoff language cleaned up, and they wouldn't agree to do that. So it left us where we were better to remain with an unsigned agreement so we could react if they laid off
again. But his question was, why didn't you put it to a vote?
Well, there was nothing really there, Jack. It wasn't a case of rejecting it. There was no benefit in accepting that.
How are you doing on strike?
Well, not too bad, but I should like to be at work.
Yeah,
okay,
I agree.
How much strike pay are you paying them?
We're paying $75 a week.
Plus more for dependents?
No.
75 flat.
75 flat.
Thanks. Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Mr. Webster.
Morning.
Yes, I was wondering if there's 6,500 union personnel from BC Hydro off the job right now. How many supervisory staff does this take to keep these guys off the job?
I'm not sure the exact numbers. I think Hydro's got roughly 1,500 or more in the SPNC.
Are these not higher-paid employees? You know, I mean, I've always understood that a supervisor gets paid a little bit more than the union personnel that he's got below him. Now, if there's only 6,500 and you say there's roughly 1,500 supervisory staff, since when does it take one person to supervise four?
Well, that's a question we would like an answer to, too. I think they're heavy in that middle management group. Although I will say that they do have a number of engineers in Hydro because of the nature of the business.
Yeah, right. Okay, well, I just wanted to get that point across. I mean, everybody seems to be knocking union personnel, and I don't think they're paid anything near what your professional staff and supervisory staff.
Just by the way, let me ask you a question, Fred. These supervisory personnel who are there right now, are they working on, do they get paid overtime?
Yes, as far as I understand it, they're paying them overtime now, and they're getting bonuses of $25 a day, $50 a day, and $100 a day, plus an extra $25 if they're out of town for doing our work while we're off.
Go ahead to Fred Trotter of the O.T.E.U.
Yes,
Yes, I'm a member of the OTU on strike, and I'd like to ask Fred, how come you're only now talking about getting a mediator involved? I mean, is it a problem with the company, or is it a problem with the union in getting a mediator? It seems to me like the IBEW settler contract through, was it Vince Reddy?
Mm-hmm. That's correct. First of all, generally speaking, a mediator can only be effective if both parties want a mediator in or see a need for him at that point in time. Right now, as I say, there's been no indication from Hydro at any point that they would be interested in a third party, and as a result, we continued up until the 30th. Now, we have suggested to them that it would help in the process. We should be looking at it.
I mean, we've been you've been talking with Hydro for 8 or 9 months now on this contract, and the IBEW seemed to be able to get a mediator quite quickly on theirs and settle out quite quickly. It seems to me like you should have done that quite a while ago.
Yeah, he's giving you hell for not going for a mediator before.
Well, as I say, you can't get one unless... I think Hydro had a plan. I think Hydro's plan was to go after one union first, 258. Now they're going to be picking on someone else, and I have a feeling that we're probably on the back burner of their list in terms of negotiations.
258 are the IBEW people working on the electrical system. Right. 213 are the 450 on the gas, and the O.T.E.U. are you the inside workers?
No, we cover a lot of outside work.
Oh.
We have people out inspection doing work in the field, too. We're not just...
office workers.
That's right.
Oh, I didn't know that. Yeah. Where am I going? Hold on, please. Mission, go ahead to Fred Trotter.
Yeah, good morning, Jack. Morning, Fred.
Good morning.
Just two questions. First of all, I'd like to know why the unions haven't picketed BC Hydro Rail and why we're allowing the hydro bills to be delivered. And I'll hang up here and listen to this.
Okay, why are you not picketing BC Hydro Rail and why are you allowing the bills to be delivered?
Okay, first of all, I'll take the last one. As long as Hydro's, that computer will turn out the estimated bills, and they get that through a strike-breaking firm in terms of being distributed and taken to the Royal Mail. Now, the Royal Mail is the Royal Mail. There is no way that you can effectively stop them sending out the bills. All we ask is people, when they receive them, if they want to see this thing end before something major happens, is don't pay them. Now, the other question you raise in terms of not the rail, we've been kicking that around for some time. The rail operation is operating at a loss. And as a result, we could see no purpose in removing a loss operation from Hydro. But that may change within days.
You're talking about the BC Freight Rail Service that runs from downtown to up the valley and all
that's
the
right.
Spud lines in Richmond and elsewhere and whatnot.
That's right.
So are you now considering of declaring the BC Rail hot or picketing it if necessary?
We are definitely considering it.
Okie dokie. Abbotsford, go ahead, please.
Webster.
One moment. Hello?
Yes, ma'am, I accept the charge.
Thank you.
Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Victoria.
Speak up.
Relatives with IBEW, and the subject hasn't been brought up. I've noticed that there's no strike pay for IBEW.
We didn't know that. Fred's only speaking for the OTEU. Mr. Dick, God Dick of 213, was to be here this morning, but he cancelled at the last minute, you know, probably for a very proper reason.
Oh, dear.
But you're on IBEW. Are you an IBEW member?
No, but my relatives are.
No strike pay?
No strike pay.
Local 258, as I understand it, don't have a strike fund.
They don't have a strike fund. 258 being?
The electrical.
Electrical workers. Go ahead, please.
Hello, I'm a member of the OTEU.
Yes, ma'am.
And my biggest complaint is that we all feel that we're, you know, quite uninformed. First of all, what they did is they took a strike vote, which seemed to be for solidarity. And the first day out on the 25th of November, when people would come up and ask why we were on strike, no one seemed to know. Also, another thing is the offer by Hydro that has been offered now of $004 and $900 cash seems good to most of us. And they don't even have a vote to see if we want to go back.
Two good points, ma'am. Hold on. Well, let's answer them now. Why don't you put the company's offer to a vote of the membership?
Jack, there's when we went out and took our strike vote, we told the members that the major issue was our job security issues. Those are unresolved. When they voted for strike, they knew that we had these major concerns. So there was nothing in terms of that. Certainly, the vote was not in terms of solidarity. We told the members that we would probably need that strike vote to resolve our issues, and also we knew that the gas workers were in trouble, okay? We did move the vote ahead because of this possibility of solidarity coming into play. Now, when the member tells me that the 004 or the $900 is acceptable, I have great difficulty with that. I consider that our members have a right to standard of living comparable with other people. And personally, at some point, the members will vote on whatever the final package is when we resolve our issues. But I have great difficulty with people who accept that they should be treated as third class within this society, and it's not my way of representing our members.
Thank you, ma'am. And you feel you've kept your members reasonably well informed?
We've done our best, Jack. We have a hotline into the office. We're trying to get a second one in so that they can call in. We've tried to distribute information as quickly as we can.
More with Fred Trotter after the break. Well, Fred, there certainly seems to be a demand for information this morning about your problems, I'll tell you. Fred Trotter of the O.T.E.U., who's leading the O.T.E.U., they're on strike, have been since the 25th of November. God, they must have lost a packet of wages. Because your average wage is what, $1,500, $1,600?
Oh, no. No, I think it's better than that in the average. Because
$2,000?
Well, we, it'd be better than that on average.
On average.
We go up to, as I mentioned, we have very senior skilled people within the bargaining unit, Jack. So, it's not a case of a clerical organization.
That's why money ain't your biggest panic.
Money, as far as we're concerned, the money, the first year, we're prepared to accept the same sacrifices as everyone else.
Okie dokie. Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Jack, Fred. It seems to me, gentlemen, this time the restraint, even a three-year agreement is too long. 2 years just seems to be the norm in the province. But getting to the hydro bills, the group of us were discussing New Year's Eve. We'd received our bills, the estimated charges. Most of us, over the last bill we received, had over 100% increase with estimations. It seems to me that they'd be making an awful, awful lot of money on us if we pay these high rates and the estimations.
Well, I would thank you for not paying them.
Well, ours alone, for with a small 800-square-foot two-bedroom home in Surrey, was $9,302 last billing date, so whatever it was. This new bill we just received there is $171. I think maybe that a lot of people are going to be dinged with this overzealous estimation on someone's part.
Good point, good point. Now, let me ask Fred a question. Are your members not paying the hydro bills?
I hope they aren't paying them.
Have any of your members had their light cut off?
No.
If any of them do, will you let me know?
Yeah, I'll let you know. We'll probably have to put them back on.
Go ahead, please.
Oh, good morning, Mr. Webster and Mr. Trotter.
Morning.
I'm a wife of an OTU member, and I'm not working, and I have two children to support. And it's not been easy, but I just wanted to say that I think it's marvelous that the union has not inconvenienced the public. And maybe that's what it takes to make someone notice that we've been out for as long as we have, unfortunately. And also, I just want to make a point on the hydro bills. I'm not paying mine because I don't have the money to pay it anyway. But also, they've changed the envelopes, if anybody's noticed. There's no BC Hydro written anywhere on those envelopes.
Funny little envelope. I noticed that the other day.
Jack, we tracked that down a little bit, and you might be interested. They put an order out to have envelopes made up, and they removed all the hydro identification from them. We found out where those envelopes were going, and we also learned that maybe the envelopes are being billed to a company other than BC Hydro. Some company, I believe we heard M&M Forest or products or something of that.
Somebody else, anyway.
That's
you're
right.
Not quite sure. Okay, why was that? So you wouldn't declare that premises hot or something?
So that no one would be able to recognize them when they come in. All they have is the box number.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, congratulations, Fred. I've always said that we should get on to somebody like Webster or that to get our point across.
It's the only place where you get your point across.
Thank you. That's too bad we had to be interrupted by Mike Harcourt. I've always felt that we're second class to IBW, and in your opinion, I see we're even lower. I disagree with your earlier caller saying that offer Hydro had made was something we should vote on. I don't like being second class to IBEW. I feel that we should have something comparable to them before we have it put to us for a vote. Thank you.
Just a minute.
Okay.
Harcourt was on because Harcourt was a news story, even if it was a negative news story. I would not insult...
Yes, I read it. I think that's a negative one as well.
Yeah, so do I. Yep. Much obliged, you smart aleck.
The thing I would note on that, Jack, is I hope the person didn't misinterpret my remark. I don't look at our members as second class or third class or anything else. What I was saying that Hydro is prepared to treat them in that manner, and it's not acceptable.
Go ahead to Fred Trotter.
He's talking about third class citizen. Well, I think 4% or a $900 bonus represents 4% of a $22,500 salary, and the $1,400 represents 4% of a salary of $35,000. So that's not second class citizens, and I think they should accept it.
Are you an O.T.E.U. member?
No.
No, but the average salary $22,000. Is that right?
$22,500, and if it's a $900 bonus, that's 4% of a $22,500. What's their average salary within the bargaining unit?
Oh, our average salary would be in excess of that in terms of average.
What do you mean excess? Give us a figure.
I would say roughly. I don't know exactly at this point, but I'd say around $2,400.
About $2,400 a month.
$2,400.
12 and 48 and 4, 12, 2, 24 and 4, 28. So that's 28,000, 29,000.
28,000 a year is an average salary. That's a pretty reasonable salary. And if they're getting a $900 bonus on a 28,000 salary, that's a pretty fair bonus.
Okay, you made your point. I'm just about out of time. Fred, it's the layoff language that you're concerned about.
The job security issues.
My thanks to Fred Trotter of the OTEU. Hopefully we'll have people from 213 of the IBEU, God Dick, perhaps on tomorrow. Take it away. Tomorrow, Kenneth Dye, the Auditor General of Canada, and Bill King, one of the declared candidates for the leadership of the new Democratic Party. That was a long 15 seconds. See you tomorrow at 9 a.m. precisely. The Forgotten Hydro strikes on check at midnight. Auditor General Kenneth Dye on Webster at 9 a.m. precisely.